Hi, my name is Jeff Avery, and I'm an academic advisor in the School of Computer Science. And I want to talk to you today about academic standings, what they are, why they matter to you, and how we determine them. So I'm going to do most of this on the web, and then we'll scribble some notes and so on to try to keep track of it all. But I want to flip over to a web browser here. All right, so where we're going to start is the degree requirements for math students. So there's actually two sets of requirements for your degree, frankly, for any degree at the university. There's the faculty requirements for your particular degree that are common to everybody in that faculty, and then there's typically specialized requirements for your plan. So in our case, we're in math, so if you go to the calendar, this is the 2021 calendar, Faculty of Mathematics, academic plans and requirements on the side, degree requirements for all math students, okay? And you get this nice little table, which is a little difficult to decipher. So I'm going to point out a few things on this that are relevant to this discussion. So first of all, just to sort of point out what you're looking at, there's a number of columns here that are sort of trying to break it down according to the type of degree that you're working towards. In computer science, we have a BMath in CS as well as a BCS degree. They're both four-year honors plans in computer science, okay? So you're going to see, you're going to fall into one of these two columns based on whether you're co-op or not co-op. And frankly, most of the requirements are identical, except for the co-op requirements. So a couple of things here that are sort of interesting. Minimum course units is the number of units you have to have to graduate, which is 20 units. Our courses are typically 0.5 units per course, so that's 40 courses, which lines up with our checklists and so on. There's things like PD course units and so on that you have to complete. But the ones that we're particularly concerned with that we use to figure out your academic standing are your minimum cumulative average, your major average, and any failures you might have. So what happens is, at the end of an academic term, your grades are submitted by your instructors. So they go to the registrar's office, they get, you know, aggregated and so on. And then at some point, somebody within the Faculty of Math and somebody within Computer Science will take a look at your record and determine if you have broken any of these requirements, okay? So we want to basically call it a bit of a flag on your account and notify you and let you know if you've not met any of the requirements that you need to graduate to figure out if we can do something about it typically. So the three requirements I'm going to talk about, minimum cumulative average, this is your average across all your courses, okay? So we start calculating that as soon as you finish your first term and we carry that all the way through, and you need to maintain a 60% average across all of your courses. The second one is a little bit more specialized. It's a major average. The major average is really the average across the courses that are considered fundamental to your particular program. So, and they're going to be different, right, based on whether you're in statistics or computational math or computer science, for instance. So if you click here to the table, this will take you to a little bit of a summary of what courses are used for the major average requirement calculation based on your program. So we're in computer science. Our MAV consists of all of these computer science courses or computer science courses that fall in this category. So we don't use CS 115, 116, or 135, any of the sort of first courses that you took. We don't include those. But we do start counting when we hit CS 136. So 136 and higher, that includes all your required CS courses as well as any CS major courses that you take towards your degree. And again, you have to have a 60% average in that. And an interesting rule, we only count once you have two or more of these completed. So at the end of first year, we're not even calculating this because you will only have CS 136 from this list. But by the time you hit 2A, certainly by 2B, you will have had a few more courses and then we'll start calculating it. Okay, so what are these things used for? Why do we care about these? Well, there's this other little section on this same page called Academic Standing Within the Faculty. And here's the rules we use to determine your particular standing. So what happens is somebody systematically goes through your records based on your last academic term and says, do you have more than four units of failed courses? Has your CAV dropped below 60? Has your MAV dropped below 60? And so on. And depending on whether you have hit any of these conditions or not, your academic standing might change. All right? Now, in terms of what the standings are, if you go down here, there's a long series of explanations for each of these. I'm not going to go into those, okay? I'm going to actually sketch out a few of them, the most common ones that you're likely to encounter. But frankly, most of these, the majority of you will never see, okay? So don't panic about that. If you want sort of a more user-friendly view as well, if you just Google UWaterloo Math Academic Standings, somebody in the Faculty of Math has put together this awesome chart, which lists literally every standing. It gives you the code beside it, DEF, CNDP, and so on, as well as a description of what it is. The codes are what are actually going to show up and what we're going to talk about. So it's actually quite useful to know what the codes are because that's what you will see on your transcripts. Okay, so I'm going to flip over here to just a bit of a sketch pad. All right, so this is just a quick little summary here of what we just said. You need to have a CAV of 60, a MAV of 60, and less than 2.0 units of failures. So that's sort of what you want to retain through the term, right? So at the end of an academic term, after you've just finished some courses, if all these things are true and your cumulative average is somewhere between 60 and 79.9%, you're considered to be in good standing, okay? That's the actual code that gets applied. There's an EXCL, which is an excellent standing. That's if you're 80.0% or higher. We give you a standing of excellent. And these are the actual terms that are going to appear, the codes that are going to appear on your transcripts for that term, okay? And this is what you want. And like I said, the vast majority of people are going to be in good standing for most of their academic career. So, however, what can happen? What can go wrong? Well, let's talk about what could go wrong. Say you have a bad term and your CAV or your MAV is less than 60%. What can happen? Well, what we're going to do is say we're going to put you in what we call conditional, CNDP. Conditional is basically that your average is too low in one of these average calculations, okay? So a condition of CNDP means it's basically a warning flag for you and for us to say, hey, something's gone wrong here. Typically, you'll get an email from us saying you're on a conditional term. And what that means is in your next academic term, you need to raise your CAV or MAV back up to 60, okay? And if you do that at the end of your next term, then we're going to put you back in good standing again at the end of your next term. So that's ideal, right? If your CAV and MAV are, you know, 60 or higher, then we're going to automatically put you back into good again, and you're fine. All right. And obviously, that's what we would like to see happen. So if you go CNDP, what we tell you is, when you get this email, don't panic. Take a deep breath, come and talk to us, and we'll help you figure out what went wrong, what you need to change, and that can be anything from changing studying habits to maybe taking four courses instead of five in a particular term to try to balance out your workload, whatever it happens to be, okay? But typically, that's the whole point of conditional terms, is to let you know what's happened and to help you get back on track. So that's the good case of what can happen here. There's a few other things that could happen, though. For instance, imagine that you know, you do better on your conditional term, but you don't quite do well enough. You know, your CAV and MAV are still below 60. That's not good. But your term average, maybe your term average is particularly good. If you get a 65 or higher on your term average, we'll actually give you another conditional term. So you would get two conditional terms in a row, okay? Your first attempt at it, where you didn't quite make it, and then again, we will give you another shot at it based upon a term average of 65 or higher. Why do we do that? Well, because it's possible that, you know, maybe back here, maybe your term was particularly bad back here. You dropped your cumulative average down to like a 57 or a 56 or something. It's really difficult to pull that back up in one term. Maybe it's going to take you a couple terms. So again, as long as we see that term average of 65 or higher, we will grant you a second conditional term and a second chance to do this. I will warn you, we will not grant a third conditional term, or at least we will not guarantee granting a third. So once you've been granted an additional conditional term, that's kind of your shot to do it, okay? But again, these are nuances you should talk through with an academic advisor. The other thing that can happen here, right? You've had your conditional term, your term average is not 65 or higher, your cumulative average or MAV is not 60, you failed to do what you needed to do during your conditional term. Unfortunately, what happens is there's another status called FLP. And again, this is CAV or MAV less than 60 coming out of a conditional term. What that means basically is that you failed to do what you needed to do in the conditional term, and you're being removed from the program. You'll receive an email from us telling you this and what it means. And generally what that means is you're no longer allowed to pursue computer science. You have to find a different plan. Okay? This doesn't happen very often, and obviously we don't want this to happen. Our goal is to arrest your downward slide, to sort of stop the problems and help you fix the problems when you're in a conditional term so you don't get to this stage. The only other thing you should worry about, and this sometimes comes up, is this is all based on cumulative average and major average, but failures are handled slightly differently. If you hit 2.0 units of failures, or sorry, more than 2.0 units of failures, do not pass, go, do not collect $200. You go directly from good down to FLP, okay? Unfortunately, that's a hard requirement. We can't give you a conditional term to improve that because you cannot unfail a course at the university. So unfortunately, you know, if you hit that, your failure count, you will go FLP as well. Like I said, there's other statuses. These are the ones that come up the most frequently, though, the ones that you should be aware of. And CNDP in particular is often a bit of a surprise to students as to how that works and what it means. So I hope that was helpful to you. If you have any other questions about this, obviously come and talk to us. We're here to help you and try to make your time here as successful as it can.